Hello and welcome to MOOC lectures on strategy and introduction to game theory. In this module, we are going to talk about infinitely repeated games. We are already familiar with the notion of repeated games. What we have learned so far is finitely repeated games. We did prisoner's dilemma, we did in which we had only one Nash equilibrium, then we talked about another simultaneous move game in which we had more than one Nash equilibrium. And also while studying chain store paradox, we learned how to talk about a finitely repeated extensive form game. But now we are going to talk about infinite repetition of a simultaneous move game. When do we need the notion of infinitely repeated game? In two different cases. One, that games that repeated forever, game that never ends, the players keep on playing their stage games forever. The second possibility is that game may end after each repetition with some positive probability. Means there is some positive probability that game will keep on happening again and again. Now, why do we need the concept of infinitely repeated game? The second type that I have talked about is very useful idea that we may not know that how many times we will interact with the other player. In that case, the notion of infinitely repeated game will help us model the situation. But here the problem is, how should we write the payoffs? Because think about, let us say that two players are cooperating forever, what we have, or defecting forever. So what we have seen in the prisoner's dilemma, that both players are earning 1 and 1. But let us say that if this prisoner's dilemma game gets repeated forever, how should we add up? Because no matter which payoff we add up, if we add any positive number for the infinite times, we will get infinity. So how can we compare infinity with infinity? That is the problem. But this is an easy one. We should be able to solve using the notion of discounted sum. I will come to this topic. I will talk about what is discounted sum. And again, the question is very similar that we were trying to answer in the case of finitely repeated game. Can we get any cooperation just because we are having this game repeated infinitely? We know that defection would sustain on its own in finite number of repetition as well as in infinite number of repetition it would sustain on its own, because in all the stages it would lead to Nash equilibrium, and we have learned that Nash equilibrium is self-enforceable. Okay. So again, coming back to the prisoner's dilemma game, this prisoner's dilemma game we saw when we studied finitely repeated game also. So one outcome is definitely that we will always get defect and defect. But is there any other equilibrium that we can get? The key element is that a player can adopt contingent strategies. What do we mean by contingent strategy? Based on some observation, contingent upon, based on some observation. So if you misbehave on this round of the game, then I will respond to you in the next round. So if you cooperate with me, I will cooperate with you. If you defect, I will also defect. And this sort of contingent strategy remains available if there is some chance that there will be a next round. We saw this didn't work in the case of prisoner's dilemma when we were talking about finitely repeated game, because after some point game ends and then this logic doesn't work out, and then when we start doing the backward induction, this logic would follow back to the first stage. But we have some hope in infinitely repeated game, as in this setting the game never ends, it keeps on repeating. So let us talk about some of the contingent strategies. One very popular one that we will study today is called trigger strategy. So if someone doesn't cooperate or misbehave, let us say we make a deal, let us cooperate. And if someone doesn't cooperate or misbehave in one round of the game, then this player can be punished in the next round. Okay? So, if the threat of punishment is sufficient to change the player's strategy, then we have found a new equilibrium and we can call them trigger strategy equilibrium. Here, remember, unlike finitely repeated game, there is no end of the game. So, we cannot begin at the end and follow back the same logic and come to the first stage. So, in a trigger strategy, what should player do? Player should begin by cooperating. They should cooperate with each other. So, in the first stage, both of them should play cooperate. So, both of them would get 2, 2. Notice what happens if it is finitely repeated game, then they always defect and get 1, 1. So, in trigger strategy, they both begin by cooperating. Now, the next thing is cooperate as long as the rivals do, all the rivals do. And upon observing a defection, let us say keep on cooperating as long as the rivals are also cooperating. And when you see a defection from the next period onward, revert to a period of punishment of a specified length in which you play defect. So, this specified length can be forever or can be for 5 period or can be for 1 period. So, let us talk about two extreme cases of trigger strategies. One is called tit for tat, that we talked about right in the beginning when we started talking about repeated games. So, whatever a player does in this round of the game, the other player will do the same in the next round. So, you are just mimicking your opponent. Okay? This is the simplest form of trigger strategy and this is most forgiving, or in other word we can say shortest memory. Why? Because punishment, if someone defects for 1 period, he gets punished only for 1 period and immediately they can go back to the cooperation. It is proportional and it is credible, but it lacks deterrence. I will emphasize this term, credible but lack deterrence, little later. As opposed to tit for tat, we have other, on the other extreme, we have Grimm trigger strategy. Grimm trigger strategy says that punishment period is forever. If a player misbehaves, if a player defects, then you punish that player forever. This is least forgiving and it has the longest memory. Means once someone defects, someone misbehaves with you, you keep on punishing that person forever. But remember, in the prisoner's dilemma game, punishing other player also means punishing yourself. So, this is not very credible because the player would be not only punishing the other player but also himself. But this has adequate deterrence in a sense that it would deter other player from cheating. So, this is the payoff stream in Grimm trigger strategy. What happens? They cooperate and cooperate in the first period and then keep on cooperating. So, when they are cooperating, what's happening? Let us look the payoff, they both are getting 2, 2. But let us say in a particular period a player defects. Since other player is cooperating, let us say player 1 keeps on cooperating and player 2 defects, then player 2 gets 2, 3 and player 1 gets 0. But this is Grimm trigger. So, player 1 would now punish him forever. So, now he is going to play defect forever. So, in that case, what would happen? The player would always earn 1, 1, because the other player is also going to defect. Other player cannot cooperate now, this is known to him. If he cooperates, he gets 0. So, he would like to have as high pay as possible. So, he would also defect. So, now if one defects in one stage, payoff would increase from 2 to 3, but in all remaining stage it would decrease from 2 to 1. So, that is what I am showing here, that let us say in period T it goes from 2 to 3, but in all remaining period it decreases to 1. Now, the idea is, if we see this is the payoff continuous stream of 2 and here let us say which one is larger, how should we determine that this stream has higher value or the stream of 3 and then 1, 1 has the higher value. How should we calculate? For that, we are going to use a notion of discount. What happens that a money that you have in your pocket is more valuable to you than money which is promised to you a year later. Why? Because several reasons. One reason could be that you can put this money in the bank and you can earn interest. So, someone tells you that I would give you 100 rupees 1 year from now. So, for that 100 rupees would be equivalent to less than 100 rupees today. Why? Because that value, let us say if it is 95 rupees, you put that 95 rupees and in a year time bank will give you 100. So, you earn interest. That can be one reason. Other reason could be that you don't know whether you would survive you would be alive 1 year later or not. Second, it's a human cycle. Third, the human psychology is that things that you would like to consume now would be more valuable. So, this is several reasons for having that discount factor. So, let us say a person is earning, there is a summation that we have one delta, because let us say one is earning in this period, one is earning in the next period, but discounted by delta, it would be delta point, delta multiplied by 1, and then for next to next period, it will be delta square 1, because here is the discounting for 1 period, here is discounting for 2 period, and similarly delta square 3, oh sorry, delta q multiplied by 1 and so on. And the idea is to sum it up. Let us indicate that this is S. This summation is called S. So, if we multiply this S with delta, what do we get? If we multiply 1 with delta, we get delta, and we will shift one place, we will write here delta. This delta point, delta multiplied 1 multiplied by delta, it is going to be delta square 1, and delta square 1 multiplied by delta would be delta cube 1 and so on. So, what we can do, we can subtract this delta S from S. Notice that delta is typically less than 1 and greater than 0, that is what we give the value of discount factor. Okay. So, what do we get? S minus delta S is basically, here if we do the subtraction, all these things will get cancelled and what we will get? 1. So, S is basically 1 divided by 1 minus delta. But let us say we have only t periods, then what happened? Then here we have 1 plus delta, delta square, delta cube, and then we have delta t minus 1. Okay? In all we have if you multiply anything by 1, you get the same number. And then again you do the same thing, you take delta s, what you would get here? Delta plus delta square plus delta q with the same logic. Here you will get delta t minus 1, and when you multiply delta to the power t minus 1 with delta, you will get delta to the power t, and take the subtraction, you will get 1 minus delta multiplied by s. Here all these things will get cancelled. What would survive? Just 1 here and minus delta to the power t here. So, in this case summation would be equal to 1 to minus delta to the power t divided by 1 minus delta. So, now we can do the calculus for Grimm trigger strategy. So, person would not like to deviate if 2, 2, 2, the stream of the payment of 2 is greater than the stream of payment of 3, 1 and then 1 in all the period. And if we take the discounted sum, what do we get? 2 here divided by 1 minus delta. Why? Because if we sum 1, the stream of 1 for infinite period, we get 1 divided by 1 minus delta. This is what we have obtained here. So, simply we can multiply 2 on all side, and here what we can do? 3 in the first period, and then what we have here? 1 from the second period to the infinite number of period. So, what we can say? This is delta, delta square and so on, which is equal to 3. If we take delta common, what do we get? 1 plus delta, delta square and so on. This we have already calculated. So, what do we get? 3 plus delta divided by 1 minus delta. So, clear, Grimm trigger strategy works if 2 divided by 1 minus delta is greater than the entity on the last side. So, if we solve it, what do we get? 2 minus delta has to be greater than 3 multiplied by 1 minus delta. Bring delta on the left hand side and numbers on the right hand side. What do we get? 2 delta has to be greater than 1, and so delta has to be greater than half. Am I right? Let us check. This is 3 minus 3 delta. Yes. So, bring 2 on the right hand side. So, 3 minus 2 is 1, and 3 delta minus delta is half. Notice this is also what we are saying, that 1 rupees tomorrow and 1 rupee in the next days has the value of only delta. In other words, if I keep delta in the bank, then I will earn some interest, and let us say it is a simple interest. So, delta multiplied by 1 plus r should give 1. So, it means we can establish a relationship between discount factor and interest rate. Delta is equal to 1 divided by 1 plus r. So, higher the delta, lower would be the interest rate. So, Grimm trigger strategy sustain on its own when delta is at least as large as, at least as large as half. Higher than half would sustain on its own. Okay. The thing is, the minimum discount rate required to sustain the collusive outcome depends on the payoff structure. Remember, what is the payoff structure? 2, 2, 3, 0, 0, 3 and 1, 1 that we obtain. It depends, the value of delta depends on the difference, the gain that one can make from cheating. So, greater relative profit from cheating, it needs larger discount rate, and smaller relative profit after cheating need smaller discount rate. So, in this particular case, we have seen that cooperation would sustain, players would cooperate forever under the threat of Grimm trigger strategy if delta is greater than half. Now, let us look at the tit for tat. What happens in the tit for tat? A player cheats, player gets 3 in this period, but in the next period other player would mimic the defect. In that period he would get 1, and again they will be back to 2, because here punishment is only for 1 period. So, here cooperation would sustain if the stream of 2, 2 is greater than the stream of 3, 1 and then 2, 2 forever. So, what do we need to say? That 2, 2 delta, because we can ignore this stream, is same as this stream here, sorry, this stream here. So, what we need to compare this 2 with these 2. So, 2 plus 2 delta should be greater than 3 plus delta. And what do we get here? Delta has to be greater than 1. So, this is not possible. It is because of payoff. Typically, what happens? It is difficult to sustain cooperation under tit for tat. Okay? There is a very small chance, okay, depending on the payoff in this particular case, because of the payoff structure, tit for tat would not sustain cooperation ever. Players would like to cheat all the time. But we saw that even with these payoff, Grimm trigger strategy would sustain cooperation. So, what we have learned, that there are 2 goals. What happens in Grimm trigger strategy? When you punish your opponent, you are punishing yourself also forever. So, that is little less credible, that to punish other you would punish yourself. Tit for tat is more credible, because you are saying I would punish you for only 1 period. But in Grimm trigger strategy, it would deter others from deviating. It would deter others from cheating. But in tit for tat, it does not have enough deterrence. Okay? So, basically the idea is to balance these 2 goals, deterrence versus credibility. But we have seen that there exists possibility in infinitely repeated game that cooperation would sustain forever. Thank you.